We all know what the word riveting means. That was a riveting film. It's deeply troubling, it's inspirational, and it's illuminating. And I'd like to salute Bryan Stevenson, all of his colleagues at Equal Justice Initiative. And I think that Mr. Stevenson deserves the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Although I must say that I doubt President Trump will give it to him. I also think we should all salute the team of Peter Kunhart and his sons George and Teddy for a remarkable film. In 1985, our guest, Mr. Anthony Ray Hinton, was a high school graduate working the night shift at Bruno's supermarket warehouse near Birmingham, living with his mother. His goals in life were pretty conventional. He wanted to make a living, pay bills, find a nice woman to fall in love with, have children, and have a car that he enjoyed driving. Today, nearly 35 years later, he is the acclaimed author of a fabulous memoir, which I have read, and I can tell you, the sun does shine. It's equal parts harrowing, infuriating, and inspiring. He's a high-profile champion of prison and criminal justice reform, a sought-after speaker, the recipient of an honorary Doctor of Humane Letters from St. Bonaventure University, who counts Oprah Winfrey among his biggest fans. He spent 30 years in between on death row, wrongfully committed of two convicted of two murders he did not commit. As you saw in the documentary, our guest became one of Bryan Stevenson's most famous clients. And he was released in April of 2015 after 30 years on death row as one of the longest serving condemned prisoners who had been exonerated since 1983. We saw how Bryan Stevenson took our guest's cause, doggedly steered his appeals through the Alabama courts to no avail before finally prevailing before the United States Supreme Court. Here, our guest played a decisive role in his own survival, keeping hope alive for three decades and even providing strategic suggestions which helped his liberation. This evening, I would like to zero in on his role in his survival and the fact that he's with us today. As we folks say in the African American community, Mr. Hinton, you made a way out of no way. So it's a profound honor to introduce to you Mr. Anthony Ray Hinton and to welcome him to the Jacob Burns Film Center.
Thank you.
I tend to doubt that many people in this audience have been on death row. Mm. Would you take us there? Tell us what it's like, what it looks like, feels like, what's it like spending time there?
Death row is a hell on earth. You're sent there to be executed. It is a place that you cannot sleep. It is a place that is constantly the smell of death. When I went to death row, as I said in the film, they was in the process of executing four men. And never in my life have I ever imagined what the human body smelled like when it had been set on fire. That alone was enough to make me sit down and say, what kind of place is this? Never did I think about that we was restoring men and women in a place only to set them on fire at some particular time and on a particular day. But more important for me, once I got to death row, I knew one thing if I knew nothing else, that I had been sent to a place that I should never have been. And my only concern at that moment was, how do I get back to where I belong?
Let's talk about how you survived on death row. We're all film buffs here. And I read that you had love affairs with Halle Berry and Sandra Bullock, and I'm really jealous of how you did that. Tell us about your love affairs and why.
Well, you know, being in a 5x7, we had no TV, we had no books, we had nothing. And in order for me to survive, I knew that I could not escape physically, so I decided to escape mentally. And the things that I did with my mind was the things that made me believe that I was free. And for whatever reason, after I visualized in my mind that I went over to see the Queen of England, I realized then that I could take my mind anywhere that I wanted to go. Mm. And at the age of 12, I said that I would never get married. But now I decided that I would get married, and I just didn't pick anybody. I picked one of the most beautiful women in the world.
Why not?
Halle Berry. And Halle Berry and I stayed married for 15 long, beautiful years up here. If there is a thing that's a perfect wife, I've never been married, so I don't know, but Halle Berry was the perfect wife. Halle Berry didn't never say anything but yes, dear, okay, dear, whatever you want to do, dear. But I didn't love Halle Berry for those reasons. I love Halle Berry because she didn't spend any money. And that was all.
But you threw Harry Berry overboard for Sandra Bullock. Now, why did you do that?
Well, for 15 years, okay. I've always kept in mind to escape. And for the first time, the warden decided that he would allow us to see a film. Never had met Sandra Bullock, didn't know who she was. And when I seen this woman driving this school bus around and around, I looked at her in a different light. She was already beautiful. And I looked at Halle in my mind, and I looked back at Sandra Bullock. And I'm thinking, if a woman can drive a bus this good, imagine what she could do with a getaway car. And as I was looking back and forth, both women, to be honest with you, I really was building my nerves up to tell Halle that I was going to divorce her. And I had decided to marry Sandra Bullock. And I finally looked at Halle and I said, I'm going to divorce you and I'm going to marry Sandra Bullock. And true to her word, Halle said, okay, dear. That's what I did.
I think of the movies and books as first cousins. And you started a book club on death row. What was the idea behind that?
Well, the idea behind that was constantly means and always doing something to be destructive. And one day I got to hollering out. You couldn't see who was living next door to you. You just knew them by name. Or you just say, hey, 12 cell, 13 cell. I began to ask them what grade did they drop out of school. And I was trying to find a way to use my time wisely. And I said, hey, guy in 5 cell, if you don't mind, tell me what grade you dropped out of school or did you finish high school. And out of 200 men, only 5 of us had a high school diploma. And I began to realize this may be one of the factors that why we have so many men committing crime. And so I had been in the book club in the free world, and it carried me places that I didn't even have to travel to go. And so one day I asked the warden, I said, warden, I would like to sit down and talk to you about having a book club. And the warden, like any warden, probably thought I was up to something. And he said, Hinton, what are you up to? I said, warden, I want to start a book club, and I want to start this book club so the men will stop tearing up the cells and put their mind on something constructive. I said, you'll be surprised at the power of what a book would do. And he told me to give him time to think about it. And finally, he thought about it. I told him that I would have my best friend Lester to buy the book, send the books in. He could go through the book to make sure they didn't have contraband. and I wanted 14 men, but he only would allow me 6 once he approved it. And I wanted men to feel and read a book, because I asked these same men, have you ever read a book before? And they would all say, no, I never read a book. I said, well, what did you learn? Did you never read a book in school? Oh, gee, to be honest with you, I barely went to school. And I just never have read a book. And then I would ask them, could they read? And they said, a little bit. And I said, well, I'm going to order a book, and I want you to read it. And I picked 6 guys that I wanted to be in the book club. The book that I chose at that particular time was Go Tell It on the Mountain by James Baldwin. And there was a particular guy that I wanted to read who happened to be a Ku Klux Klansman. And I wanted him to read, for the first time, a black author book. And I chose him for a specific reason, because he had been taught to hate all his life. And I wanted to show him a different side. And so that's how the book club became famous in the prison. And I never heard of anything being cut out because of its success. But the warden had to cut it out because all 200 men wanted to be in the book club, and he wouldn't allow that.
You mentioned the KKK member. I think his name was Henry Hayes.
Yes. Tell us,
you said about trying to convert him. Why did you do that?
Well, you know, to be honest with you, I asked myself, why was I put on death row for a crime that I didn't commit? All my life, I've been brought up to believe in God and trust in God. And the day that I was convicted, I said, God don't live here anymore. I thought God had let me down, failed me. And then I wanted to find a reason why I believe that God allowed me to go to prison. And just not prison, but to death row. And that's how Henry came in. And to this day, I truly believe that he allowed me to go to prison to meet Henry and show Henry love. And let me give the audience a little taste about Henry. From the day Henry was conceived, his father, his mother, taught him to hate. And as Henry went to school, he used every racist slur that he could think of. In the state of Alabama, there's no law that when you use racist slur, that the teachers have to call the authority. But in Alabama, if you go to school and the teachers know there's a mark on you, by law, she have to call Child Protective Service. And we love to say in this country, it takes a village to raise a child. And I wonder, where was this village when this young boy was being taught to hate and taught by his own father and mother and community? And so, to tell you a little about his crime, his father, when he got of age, he told him to go out and kill the first African-American male he came across. He came across a 19-year-old mentally retarded black male, him and 2 other Klansmen. They befriended this black male. They got him in the car. They stabbed him 65 times. That wasn't enough to satisfy Henry. Henry got out of the car, threw the rope over the power line, and hung this young 19-year-old black male. But that wasn't enough to satisfy Henry. Henry took out his knife and cut off the male's genitals, and that seemed to satisfy Henry. Well, they arrested Henry, tried him, convicted him, and this village that I said takes a village to raise a child came out and tried Henry, convicted Henry, and said this would be a better world if he wasn't in it. So Henry came to death row. We talked every day. I didn't know who Henry was. And finally, about 2 weeks to 3 weeks, another African-American male asked me, did I know who I was talking to every day? And I said, yes, Henry. He said, but that's just not Henry. That is Henry the Ku Klux Klansman. That is the man that hung and cut off this black boy's genitals. And I goes back to my cell, and I said, Henry, why you didn't tell me who you were? Henry didn't respond. But then I had to ask myself a question. And I asked myself, did it matter who Henry was? And I had to be honest with myself. And I said, no, it didn't matter, because my mother had always taught me to have compassion for people. And my mom said, no matter what one does in life, he or she deserved compassion. And as I got to know Henry, if anybody needed compassion, it was Henry. And so every day I would talk to Henry, and I got Henry into the law library one day, and I took a pen and I stuck myself. And there was just a little bit of blood come out. And I said, oh, Henry, red blood, Henry, red blood. Henry, what color is your blood? I know it's not red because you've been told we're different. Henry said, Ray, you know what color my blood is. I said, no, Henry, you got to have a different color blood. I said, huh, Henry, stick yourself and see what color your blood is. And Henry said, I'm not going to do that. And for 15 years, I tried to deprogram Henry all the ugliness that his father had taught him. And then one day, the state of Alabama set Henry an execution date. Henry requested the warden that I be with him up until the time they execute him. The warden granted that. Henry and I laughed and we talked. And I've always believed that laughter is good for the soul. And when on that evening they brought Henry his dinner tray, and when they took the lid off his dinner tray, it was an 8-ounce steak. I looked at Henry and I said, Henry, you ready to die? And he said, Ray, what you mean? I said, is that all you want, is an 8-ounce steak? Henry looked at me and said, yes. And he looked at me and he said, Ray, can I ask you a question? I already knew what the question was going to be. He said, if it ever come your time, what is it that you going to want? I said, Henry, for my last meal, they're going to have to go into the forest and get it. I said, when they go out in the forest and bring it back, I'm going to say, that ain't what I said I wanted. You got to go back to the forest and get it. I said, and every time they bring it back, that ain't what I want. I said, Henry, in other words, if there's a law that say I can't be executed until I eat my last meal, I'm going to be here forever. I said, but you ready to die. Well, Henry ate his steak at 6 o'clock. They asked me to leave, and they shaved Henry's head. In Alabama, they ask you two questions. What is your last meal? And do you have any final words? Henry had ate his final meal. And they asked him, did he have any final words? And Henry was quoted as saying, all of my life, my mother, my father, my community taught me nothing but hate. The very people that they taught me to hate for the last 15 years are the people that showed me nothing but love. And today, as I leave this world, I leave this world knowing what love feels like. And I truly believe
How far was yourself from the execution chamber?
About 30 feet.
How many people were marched past your cell to the execution chamber?
54.
How did you and your fellow inmates, what did you do when your fellow inmates were marched to the chamber and during the execution and afterwards, and why?
We would beat on the bars and we would beat on anything we can find, and that was a signal to the executor that we don't know whether you have family members, friends, but we want you to know that we are here for you. And we wanted you to leave this world knowing that someone did love you, someone did care about you. And as I said, we beat it as loud as we could. The guard would tell us he heard you. He smiled when he heard you beat. And I just felt, and all of us felt, that even in a dying hour, someone needed to know that they was cared for as well as they was being loved. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did.
Now, you were on death row for 30 years. Did you ever give up hope?
I didn't give up. I said I was angry with God for allowing me to go to prison. But I never did give up. I truly believe that one day I would be free, but I never allowed my mind to think of freedom. I used my mind. I played baseball for the Yankees 6 straight years.
Me too. Me too.
Oh, yes.
You're young.
And I played basketball for the pathetic Knicks, who I love to death. And we won a championship every year. And then when I got through playing basketball, I played tennis with against Nadal and Roger Phillip and all of the good. And I won Wimbledon 5 straight years. And what I'm so disappointed in to this day is that I won Wimbledon 5 straight years and I have yet to receive my Rolex watch. That's what gets me, and I think I deserve my Rolex watch.
I think I read you say that spending your days waiting to die is no way to live.
No.
What did you mean by that?
To be in a cell where you constantly think of death. You think you know how they're going to kill you. You know the exact time they're going to kill you. You know exactly the means that are going to come and get you. And you have to work with and live with and see these men every day of your life until that day is. And you try to start a relationship with them because as hard as they try not to form a relationship, I don't think there's any way that you can be in a place 365 days a year, 20 years, 15 years, and not form a relationship. But these are the same men that you laugh with, talk with, are the ones that are going to come and help prepare you to be executed. And you can't help but to think about it. And I was just able to do something that no other death row inmate was able to do. I was able to take my mind and just go wherever I want every day. Never was at the prison. I just went somewhere. Mm-hmm. And that's the power of books. I would read and I would go to California. I would go wherever I wanted to go.
Right. You rolled the dice at one point. You were offered a plea deal and you rejected it. What were the risks that you took in rejecting it and why did you reject it? Well, what was the deal that you were offered?
I was offered life without parole. And my mother at the age of 12, I never will forget it. She called me into her living room and she said, I don't want you to ever say you did something when you didn't do it. She said, I want to give you a nugget is what I call it. She said, if you're man enough to bend down and pick up a rock, and if you're man enough to throw that rock, then you should be man enough to say you throw that rock. And I told the lawyer this is one rock that I didn't throw. He said, well, I can get you a life without parole. And I said, life without parole is for guilty people, not innocent people. I said, the state of Alabama know that I'm innocent, but the state of Alabama, if they are hell-bent on executing me for a crime they know that I didn't commit, so be it. At some point in some time, we all must die. I don't want to die for something I didn't do. But if that's the way it is, so be it. But I could never stand up and say I did something when I didn't do it. And I told the lawyer, I said, on one hand, you're trying to save my life, but on the other hand, you're taking my life from me. I said, I could never, never stand up and say I did this when I didn't. I said, so if the state of Alabama execute me, so be it. What people don't realize is that in the state of Alabama, if you plead guilty, and if they give you life without parole, the actual murderer can come and say, this man didn't do it, I did it. The state of Alabama do not have to let me go because I stood up and I pleaded guilty to that crime.
You confessed to it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. BRYAN STEVENSON entered your life at some point, and you made a pivotal contribution to his defense strategy when you talked about ballistics. Why were ballistics so important, and what advice did you give him? What strong recommendation did you give him about ballistics?
My case revolved around ballistic and ballistic only. The gun that they got from my mother home, they said it was the murder weapon. I knew that that gun hadn't been fired in 25 years. And My ballistic expert during my regular trial was a one-eyed blind civil engineer. He was not a ballistic expert, and that's what they convicted me on. And so when Brian Stevenson came into existing in my life, I told Mr. Stevenson, I said, Mr. Stevenson, if no two guns is alike, I already know that the state of Alabama is lying. And I said, Mr. Stevenson, I need you to do me a favor. And he looked at me and he said, what is the favor? I said, I need you to hire a qualified ballistic expert. I said, but I need this ballistic expert to be a Southern white man.
Man?
Yes.
Not woman?
Not woman. I said, Mr. Why? Stevenson, I lived in the South all of my life, and the South only recognized one of their own. I said, Mr. Stevenson, you can go out and get the best white female in the country. Her word is no good on the witness thing. And it definitely cannot be a person of color. He have to be a Southern white man. I said, but I need this Southern white man to just tell the truth. I need him to be the best of the best. But above all of that, I need him to just tell the truth. Here I am on death row for a crime I know that I didn't commit. And now I got to worry about what race a person is that can help me. I knew that in Alabama, a white female could not get on the witness stand and say that the bullets do not match. I knew a person of color could not get on the witness stand and say the bullets do not match. I knew that it had to be a Southern white gentleman. And I told Mr. Stevenson, I need you to find this Southern white man, and I need him to believe in the death penalty.
And believe in the death penalty?
Yes.
Why?
I needed him to believe in the death penalty because a person that believes in the death penalty should never want an innocent person to go to death row if they're innocent. And I wanted this Southern white man to believe in the death penalty because the state of Alabama is a death penalty state. And having a white man that is from the South that believe in the death penalty, if he say the bullets don't match, they were gonna believe him. And Brian Stevenson went out and hired three of the world-renowned experts. Two of them live in Texas and one of them live in Virginia. And they came down at three separate occasions and they tested the gun and the bullets. And they told Brian Stevenson that the state of Alabama had made a terrible mistake. But I want to be honest with you. The state of Alabama did not make a mistake. The state of Alabama knew from day one that those bullets didn't match. And the expert that Brian Stevenson hired, they asked the state of Alabama to come and show us how did you get a match. And the state of Alabama refused because there is no law that can govern them to come and re-examine the bullets. And what bothers me more than anything is that for 16 long years extra, I sit on Alabama death row, and the state of Alabama knew that the bullets never did match. And finally, the United States Supreme Court ruled that I was entitled to a new trial. And even then, the prosecution came to the judge and said, Your Honor, it is sad that we have to report to this court that we have lost the gun in question. And the judge gave them time to find the gun. She gave us another court date to come. We goes back to court. The prosecution stand up and say, Your Honor, it is with deep pride and deep pleasure that I inform the court we found the gun, but we have lost the bullets that go to the gun. All of this time, I was still living in a fire by seven. And finally, the prosecution called one of his experts and asked him to come back and re-examine the bullets one last time. And when he came back and re-examined the bullets, he said, these bullets do not match the way they did 30 years ago. But I promise you they match exactly the way they did 30 years ago. Bullets are like fingerprints, they don't change. And had it not been for Bryan Stevenson, had it not been for God sending me his best lawyer, his number one lawyer, I would not be here today.
Absolutely. But had it not been for you being an expert on ballistics, you might not be here today. Yeah,
true.
Did the state of Alabama ever apologize for what they did to you for saying that a retrial and reexamination of the evidence would be a waste of taxpayer time? Did you ever get an apology?
I have never received an apology. I have never received one dime from the state of Alabama. The state of Alabama is somewhat of a country of its own. And as I said in that clip, men of power will never apologize to a person of no power. They knew for 30 years that I was not the person who committed the crime, but yet the state of Alabama, no one have had the decency to say, Mr. Hinton, we're sorry. They took 30 years of my life, and it's hard for me to fathom that no one of power have had the decency to say we're sorry. And that's Alabama for you.
There are states, I gather, that provide compensation.
They do.
Connecticut, $6 million for one case. Have you sought compensation?
I sought compensation the first year I sought it. They said that they was more important things to do. They was trying to impeach Governor Bentley. They impeached Governor Bentley. The next year, I applied for again, and the Attorney General is saying that I was never found not guilty by a jury, I'm not entitled to receive a dime. And that was Alabama way the prosecution knew that he could not get a conviction because the truth had finally come out. And the way that he structured dropping all charges, that gave him the ability to say, well, he was never found not guilty by a jury. But the state of Alabama know that those bullets didn't match. They know that I wasn't the person who committed the crime, but they used a tactic to keep me from receiving one penny.
You've become one of the country's highest profile advocates for ending the death penalty. What is your, how are you going about your advocacy and what is your message?
I tell the story, my story. I tell that we have, a lot of people would say we have a broken system. I really don't feel we have a broken system. I feel that the system is working exactly the way they have designed it to work. It is. We live in a country where if you're poor and innocent, and if you don't have the money to hire a decent defense, you're going to prison. We live in a country that if you're rich and have money, they treat you better. And so I try to educate the public about a system that I truly feel that all of us are responsible for. Because the next time it could be someone you love. The next time it could be someone you really know. And so by experiencing what I have, I go out and I tell my story, how it happened, why it happened, and I think all of us bear responsibility. Whether you live in Alabama, whether you live in New York, the government was going to kill me in New Yorker's name. And I think every New Yorker has a responsibility to stand up and say, I don't want you to kill in my name. You see, Alabama don't say, I killed in the name of the citizen of Alabama. They kill in the name of justice. And if you believe in justice, then you should stand up and say, I don't want you killing in my name, whether you're in Alabama or what state it is.
You were obviously wrongfully accused of murder, but on death row you got to know men who had actually murdered people. What do you think of the argument that death sentence is a deterrent to murder?
Well, it sounds good in theory, but there's a study and there's statistics that says states that don't have the death penalty, murder rate is far lower than states that do have a death penalty. While the state of Alabama, murder rate is at an all-time high, and they have the death penalty. No politician with a straight face can look you in the eye and tell you the truth that the death penalty is a deterrent. It's not. The death penalty is used for political gain. It is used so that the victim family can feel somewhat of some justice. But I've had the pleasure of meeting some victim that the execution had taken place, and they all say, Mr. Hinton, I still don't have any closure. And this man been executed 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. I still don't have any closure. And I always tell them, you can only get closure from God. Killing that man was not going to give you any closure. And the prosecution or whoever told you that it was, they told you a lie. We in this country, we seek revenge. And I think that on a moral standpoint, none of us has the right to take a life. What makes the state have the right to take another human being life when you killing a person that you put in jail and on death row for killing a person? I had the privilege of seeing a death certificate of one of the fellow death row inmates. And on that death certificate, it didn't say but one word, and that word was homicide. And when I see homicide, that's mean this person's life was taken without anyone giving account for it. And I just think it is wrong. It does not make you any safer at all. In fact, in the little state of Alabama, let me give your audience a little financial. In the state of Alabama, it costs over $2 million to execute a person. $2 million. We have over 200 and perhaps 50 people. And in that same state, we have not put a dent in crime. In Alabama, have in the last 2 months probably executed at least 4 or 5 people. And still the murder rate is still the same. Don't let anyone fool you and tell you that having a death penalty. And you have this argument out there, well, what if you use it more? Well, what if they had executed me in 5 years? What if they had executed me in 10 years? You would have executed an innocent man. I truly believe every man and woman that sits on death row throughout this country should be given every opportunity to prove they're innocent. And if they don't, then all of us are to blame when we kill innocent people.
We live in a very polarized, traumatized society that doesn't seem to know how to get along with each other. And you said that you, on death row, you lived a life where you knew unconditional love and you learned how rare that is. What did you mean by that?
Death row is the only place that I ever lived that I never experienced any racism. Even when Henry was on death row, Henry did not feel any racism. And I got to thinking, why was that? First and foremost, I believe it is because all of us was facing death. All of us ate the same food. All of us wore the same kind of clothes. All of us was entitled to the same as everyone else. And I truly believe that that was one of the factors that made death row unique in the sense that you didn't hear anyone refer to another human being as anything but by their name. And it made me wonder, why is it that I had to go to death row to experience no racism, but yet the moment I came home, I experienced racism on top of racism. And when I go to college, young student asks me, Mr. Hinton, do you feel that racism is better today compared to when you come up as a child? To be honest with you, I think racism is worse today than it was in the 50s and 60s. And the reason I say that is because we do it now undercover. You see, the Ku Klux Klan figure out a way. They took off the white robe and they put on the black robe. And everything now is done legal. And everything is done to depress people of color, people. And so to me, I had thought in my warped mind that once I came back, there would be no racism. I thought people would finally judge you for your character, not for the color of your skin, but I was sadly wrong. I see it every day. I dress pretty decent. And every time I go in Macy's, every time I go in Belts, I am being watched. But yet, a white man come in Belt, he have room to just go up and down the aisle as he please. And he are the one, he is the one that's stealing your blind. But yet your eyes is on me because of the color of my skin.
Let me close with one question, then I know the audience has questions, so let's make sure that we've got the microphones out. Are we all set for Q&A? When you got your license for your car, why did you put your name on it?
I put it on there to show Alabama I was not trying to hide. When a police officer get behind me, I wanted him to know, yes, that's Mr. Hinton. And so I was proud to put that tag on there. And I got my mother's name in my truck in the window as well. People ask me all the time, why do you still live in Alabama? To be perfectly honest with you, I have just as much right to live in Alabama as anyone else. And if I came to New York, New York cannot honestly tell me they don't have racism because racism is in every state. So I choose to stay where I'm at, and I choose to try and break the walls down to stop racism in Alabama.
Doctor of Humane Letters, Anthony Ray Hinton, thank you so much. Thank you. Other questions?
Yes. Hi. Thank you so much for sharing your wisdom for surviving this injustice. I'm deeply touched. I was wondering, during this time of incarceration and on death row, how was your family coping, and who was there as support for you from, aside from Mr. Stevenson, I was so touched in the movie by when you left the prison and saw the embrace of your family. I felt that it was so moving to me. So I'm wondering, during your incarceration, how did you keep in touch and what was their roles in your life?
While I was there, I lost my mother, my father, three of my sisters. I'm the baby of 10. But for whatever reason, God blessed me with one of the best friends you could ever have. Lester Bailey, and if you read, get the book, he and I have been friends ever since I was 6 and he was 4. And we've been friends for 59 years, and he drove over 500 miles round trip every week to make sure that I felt that I wasn't alone. He would bring my mother, and when she passed, him and his wife kept going. So I had the support of him and his wife. My family, they lived in California, Cleveland, different places, and I didn't see them until I came out of prison. I won't sit here and say that they didn't love me, but I didn't think about my family other than my mom. It's funny how we as society, when someone has been accused of a horrible crime, we look at the family as though they've done something. And I can't speak for them. I never will forget the day that I came home, they throw this party. And I told my brothers and sister, you didn't come see me for 30 years. I forgive you for that. But now you got to find a way to forgive yourself. But I didn't think, because God blessed me with one of the best friends a man could truly have. And we live less than a block from each other now. We have keys to each other's house. We have keys to each other's cars. And we only have one rule. whoever car you drive, you bring gas back in that car. And that's it. But being on death row and having the support, regardless of where it come from, it is an amazing thing, and it gives you strength where you're weak, and it lets you know that at least somebody are still believing. And I couldn't have a better support. My mom passed in 2002, and my best friend, he just kept going, him and his wife, and was there until the day that I was released. And so I wish that every man and every woman throughout this country could be so blessed to have someone that is willing to sacrifice their time, their money, to come in and see about you. Thank you.
Yeah.
I can't even begin to say how moved I've been by this entire evening, and what a beautiful person you are in every way. Do you believe there's such a thing as reparation? And if it is there a practical reparation? Is there something that can literally be done? Because I know I get a picture sort of what you would believe to be real reparation, and it sounds like something that has to be done on an individual level for every single person in this country, by every person in this country. But assuming that that's impossible, do you believe in reparation, that there can be such a thing?
I really do. You know, I think that all of us have been given two things. Whether we decide to use it or not is up to you. I think all of us inside of us have compassion. I think all of us know how to use humanity. We choose who we want to give those things to. But sometimes we need to stop looking at what a person done and find ways to help that person. If you could go to Alabama and just go down the row and talk to each and every individual and find out what made them do what they did, you couldn't help but to have sympathy for them. The thing that I found more than anything, every man on Alabama death row will stand up and say, I did what they say I did. But then they'll say, but I want to tell you why I did it. I was so hooked on drugs. All I was trying to do is steal something to get the next high. You know, we looks and we want to blame everything but what we should blame. We, all of us, should be concerned that drugs is taking our sons and daughters, making them commit horrible crime simply because they want to get high. And reparation is something that I think all of us should consider. Maybe it's not for everybody, but I truly believe in it. And I think you have to find a way that you can help someone. And I truly believe that when you find a way to help someone, not only do you help that person, it makes you feel good as well. It truly do.
Question down the front. One more question up front. Yep.
I hate this to have this as the last question. It's a bit of other direction, a personal experience. Which is worse, life in prison or rooting for the Knicks?
Well, I won't have to say life in prison, but you know what? The Knicks spend all of that money, and they have decent player. I just wish if I could just get to the owner and say, let me coach the Knicks for 1 year, I would really make the Knicks a winner. They have the tools. I really believe that.
On sale outside, I can testify this is a remarkable book.
And let me say, please, this is the second best book that ever been written. I say that with all honesty. If you buy this book, if you read this book, and if this book do not touch you, change your life, I have one of my lawyers here. I will give you his name and card, and he will refund your money back. Thank you so much.
Mr. Anthony Ray Hinton, thank you.